Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. First topic of today is bonehead ideas. Now, so you've got this eloquent young man named Mr. Biden who flops around from different things, so let's let him speak for himself.
Roosevelt clearly had the right to send to the United States Senate and the United States Congress a proposal to pack the court. It was totally within his right to do that. He violated no law. He was legalistically absolutely correct, but it was a bonehead idea.
Bonehead idea, definitely.
So Republicans rejoice that Jerry Nadler is handling strategy for 2022. You're guaranteed to retake the House and the Senate.
Yeah, I don't think so. So I disagree with Trey Gowdy here because it's not. He's acting like, oh, the Republicans, well, you know, we're going to have our chance again. He's assuming that there's a fair game being played here, and there isn't. It's clearly just from the election results. He just thinks in 2022 they're going to have the elections back in. They're all going to play by the same rules, and we're going to get our chance. And because the Democrats are have been caught out in lie after lie after lie after lie after lie, that the people will see, and they will vote accordingly. Well, not if the courts are courts are packed, not if the elections are going to be done the same way that they were done previously, with scrutineers from the Republicans being refused access to scrutinize the votes, all the shenanigans that went on there. So the thing I think with Republicans is they think it's a fair fight, and it's not a fair fight. And I think the quicker that they get over the fact that it's not a fair fight, these guys are fighting dirty, and we need to do the same thing, I think things will go a lot better for the Republicans. Now, there's some new blood coming into the Republican Party, and I think they're probably going to be the ones who are going to take up the mantle and fight. I think they have the wherewithal to do this. Not so much the old guard. So I think the old guard need to kind of step aside and let some new blood come into the game.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. All right, the next clip, everything is climate change. Now, this I find hilarious.
The climate crisis is a crisis born of injustice, and it is a crisis born of the pursuit of profit at any and all human and ecological cost.
That's right.
Which means...
Now, I can't believe that all these... I mean, she's talking absolute piffle, okay? So she's saying that social justice, racism, blah, 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 everything is based on is climate change. I mean, that's called conflating, right? When you're lumping everything into one. And these numbnuts behind are actually clapping. It's like, oh, yeah, gee, we never thought of that. Wow. I mean, really? Listen to the rest of it.
That we must recognize in legislation that the trampling of indigenous rights is a cause of climate change. The trampling of racial justice is a cause of climate change, because we are allowing people and we are allowing ourselves to make sure to we are allowing folks to deny ourselves human rights and deny people the right to health care, the right to housing and education.
So health care, housing, education, everything, it's all climate change. I don't know. It doesn't make sense to me. Maybe someone on the Democrat side can enlighten me.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. Okay, something funny. This is kind of hilarious. This is I didn't know this, but I think they're kind of correct.
Not that you dated any other princes.
I did.
Really? which one?
Pretty much all of them. Prince Carl Philip of Sweden, Prince Pierre Kasaragi of Monaco, Prince Hussein bin Abdullah of Jordan, so good looking. Prince Lorenzo Borghese of Italy, who I understand has his own spaghetti day.
Still, I was the one lucky enough to marry you.
Luck had nothing to do with it. You were just the easiest prince to control.
Very telling. I think there's a lot of truth in that. She was a bit of a royal... I wouldn't say groupie, a royal man trap, definitely. But yeah, it'd be interesting to fact check and see whether she actually did tout herself around, so to speak. And if that's true, it says a lot to her about her motives. It really has nothing to do with the Queen. They were just quote-unquote tolerant enough to put up with her crap. And they've got a supportive media to back them.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off!
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday. And hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. It's not very praiseworthy for the people who are doing it. Okay, what's next? And the good thing is that I'm Australian, so I've got no dog in this fight. I'm on the outside looking in.
I got a fine for $25,000 for selling e-bikes. This gentleman has a bike shop where he sells electric bicycles. Now, he got a fine for $25,000, and he says that this happened about 5 or 6 years ago. So a lot of people are saying that due to COVID and the city losing out on money, that they're trying to milk businesses for new revenue by scamming them in any way they can. And by all means, I completely believe that the city will do that. However, it's important to understand that the city's actually been doing that for a really long period of time. Now, the law that exists, it happened, I think, after 2004, as he explained, there was a 16-year-old kid that crashed and died on some mini gas bicycle whatever thing, and because one person died, they created this restrictive legislation that banned e-bikes for everybody. Because, you know, if one person died in a car, we would definitely get rid of cars for everybody. You know? So the way it works is that a throttle assist bike is illegal. So if I, you know, press a button and I can go, or I turn the handle and I can go, that is illegal. The whole way it works is that it's illegal if it can be propelled without human assistance. So if I just turn it and the bike's going on its own, that's illegal. However, a pedal assist bike is not illegal. What pedal assist means is that the bike itself cannot operate as a motorcycle. It can't go on its own. You need to pedal. What the motor does is it makes your pedaling easier. So if you push, it's going to push a little bit harder because the motor is assisting you in pedaling. These types of bikes were never considered illegal under the law. He explained this to the inspector, and he didn't care. You know, he said that the inspector didn't even look around the store. He literally walked in and wrote a violation. He never went behind the counter to look at the bikes. He never asked about them. He never tried it out or anything like that to see if he was selling ones with throttles. He didn't care. He gave him a fine for $25,000 anyway. He said, well, you know, I'm not going to sign this because you're telling me I'm doing something that I'm not doing. The law does not say that this is illegal. And the inspector says, well, if you don't do that, I'm going to call the police and make you sign it. Great job, New York City. So he goes to court, he hires an attorney, and he gets the fine overturned. And what the interesting thing is that they were able to get clarification on the law to ensure that the DCA cannot do this anymore right after City Bike, that was sponsored for over the, I think it was like, they have like a $30 or $40 million contract with City, over the period of 5 years, when they wanted it to start doing the city bikes, which are pedal assist electric bikes that you can rent, they immediately clarified the law. And one of the things that's interesting is if you ride around New York City, you'll see that every single Grubhub, DoorDash, Seamless delivery person, every single one is using a bike with a throttle. Every single one. Because if you want to do food delivery around the city at the pace that's necessary to pay the inflated rents that are that as they've gone up to be able to live here, you need to be able to do deliveries faster. The speed that you were doing deliveries at 10 or 20 years ago, that was when your rent was $1,000 cheaper for your apartment or $5,000 or $10,000 cheaper for your restaurant. The demand for these apps like Grubhub and Seamless, how they've increased the use of food delivery being more popular during the pandemic, but above all, the fact that everything's more expensive here, you need to make more money. So the way they do it, the way they make their deliveries is on these electric bikes. And they are literally everywhere. They all have those little Arrow 7s or Arrow 9s. They're not as fast as my bike, but they have a throttle on it. And you don't see people dying left and right on these things. Not at all. And they tried to make these legal a few years ago, but unfortunately, Emperor Cuomo vetoed it. So there was an attempt to make this legal. The state politicians voted 137-4 in favor of legalizing that particular type of electric bike, and Cuomo vetoed it. And to this day, it is still vetoed. I've read around, and it seems like he had some beef with one of the sponsors of the bill because they said something not so nice about him on social media, which is just go figure.
Interesting. Bureaucracy gone mad and Emperor Cuomo. I love his reference there. Emperor Cuomo. I hope he gets his justice because he's a piece of work, that guy, in my opinion. COVID debunked. Okay. Are we doing anything else? Yeah. New York fine frenzy. Will's gone mad. All right.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. Okay, this is called Separation of Powers, and this is regarding the Chauvin case. The only way that you stop a tyranny is when you have the people who make the laws separate from the people who are enforcing the laws. So when the judiciary, the people who are enforcing laws, are separate and have no impact on the people who make the laws and vice versa, then you have some chance of justice. But when you get people like Maxine Waters trying to affect the outcome of a case for political gain, anyway, this is what the judge had to say, and I think he's 100% correct.
I'm aware of the media reports. I'm aware that Congresswoman Waters was talking specifically about this trial and about the unacceptability of anything less than a murder conviction and talk about being confrontational, but you can submit the press articles about that. This goes back to what I've been saying from the beginning. I wish elected officials would stop talking about this case, especially in a manner that is disrespectful to the rule of law and to the judicial branch and our function. I think if they want to give their opinions, they should do so in a respectful and in a manner that is consistent with their oath to the Constitution to respect a co-equal branch of government. Their failure to do so, I think, is abhorrent, but I don't think it is prejudiced with additional material that would prejudice this jury. They have been told not to watch the news. I trust they are following those.
So, in a democracy, okay, it's people rule. We get that. But there's a really fine line between people rule and mob rule. And the reason why you have the separation of powers is that the mob, in this case, led by this person, that the mob cannot influence what's right. Now, I think Chauvin, guilty, yes, but not of murder, manslaughter, accidental. I just don't understand why. I mean, to me, the real reason is, why would they teach those sorts of techniques? I can't believe that a police academy would train their officers to kneel on someone's neck. Someone has taught them that. Now, that's the question I want to ask. Was Chauvin, or were police officers, are police officers, taught that as a legitimate technique? Because that is the most stupidest technique to provide someone. They got tasers, they got everything else, and what, you have to kneel on someone's neck? In Sydney here, we've had, in Australia, we've had a couple instances where bouncers have done the same thing, kneeling on a patron's neck. And the guy's died. He's going, I can't breathe. Just exactly the same thing as George Floyd. I can't breathe. I can't breathe. This guy's just suffocating in front of him. And they think it's all right to just kneel on his neck and hope the guy. I mean, you got cuffs. Once you get him on the ground, surely you can kneel on his back, on the top of his back, until someone can put the cuffs on him. Anyway. So to me, George Floyd incident, as tragic as it is, not denying that, no one's asking the question, is this how they train the police to kneel on someone's neck? Because that's not appropriate at all.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it.
Presentation, we will bring to you the stand of one of the founding fathers of the United States, George Washington, as regard to slavery. This extract is gotten from the book, Black Rednecks and White Liberals, by Dr. Thomas Sowell. George Washington was one of those who had inherited slaves, and, dying childless, freed his slaves in his will, effective on the death of his wife. His will also provide that slaves too old or too beset with bodily infirmities, not able to take care of themselves, should be taken care of by his estate, and that the children were to be taught to read in his estate. In fact, he continued to pay for the support of some freed slaves, for decades after his death, in accordance with his will. And the tone, as well as the length of it, showed his concerns. The Emancipation Clause stands out from the rest of Washington's will, in the unique forcefulness of its language. Elsewhere in it, Washington used the standard legal expressions, I give and bequeath, it is my will and direction. In one instance he politely wrote, by way of advice, I recommend to my executors. But the Emancipation Clause rings with the voice of command. It has the iron firmness of a field order, I do hereby expressly forbid the sale of any slave I may die possessed of, under any pretext whatsoever. Long before reaching this point in his personal life, George Washington had said of slavery as a national issue, there is not a man living who wishes more sincerely than I do to see a plan adopted for the abolition of it. But, like Burke, he saw a need for a plan of some sort, rather than simply freeing millions of slaves in a newly emerging nation surrounded by threatening powers, just as the freed slaves themselves would be surrounded by a hostile population. In short, the moral principle was easy, but figuring out how to apply it in practice was not. Moreover, in a country with an elected government, how the white population at large felt could not be ignored. When Washington congratulated Lafayette for the latter's purchase of a plantation where former slaves could live, he added, "Would to God a like spirit would diffuse itself generally into the minds of the people of this country, but I despair of seeing it." He saw legislation as the only way to end slavery and said that a legislator who did that would get his vote. Slaves that Washington took north with him after completing his terms as president, in effect freeing them on the sly, as one biographer put it, at a time when to free them officially could have set off controversies. George Washington was, after all, trying to hold together a fragile coalition of states bearing little resemblance to the world power that the United States would become in later centuries. As a slave owner in Virginia, Washington thought of ways he might sublet much of his estate, in which his current slaves might be hired by the year, as laborers by tenant farmers. He was clearly casting about for some way, as he put it in a letter, to liberate a certain species of property which I possess very repugnantly to my own feelings. But there were no takers. Washington's behavior as a slave owner is also worth noting. Beginning in the early 1770s, he rarely bought a slave and he would not sell one, unless the slave consented, which never happened. Not selling slaves was an economic loss. Slave labor on a plantation with soil as poor as Mount Vernon brought in little or nothing.
The only profit a man in his position would make was by selling slaves to states where agriculture was more flourishing. Washington would not. I am principled against selling Negroes as you would do cattle at a market. From 1775 until his death, the slave population at Mount Vernon more than doubled. Even a sympathetic biography of George Washington, for example, said, he had helped to create a new world but had allowed into it an infection that he feared would eventually destroy it. This statement is breathtaking in its assumptions. That he feared would eventually destroy it. Even to have made slavery a public issue at the time would have accomplished nothing except to jeopardize the survival of a fragile coalition of newly independent states. Yet this man who contributed more than anyone else to the introduction of free republican government in the modern world is widely seen as being under a moral cloud, as if he had chosen to introduce or abet slavery.
I just think people who look at history from their today's lens are going to get a skewed vision. You need to see what happened in that time and judge the person for what they did with that particular point of view, that perspective. First president of the United States, for all that he did, and they're trash talking him now. I think it's not very praiseworthy for the people who are doing it.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. For the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. Clip. Governor Jenner. All right, a bit of a change of pace.
Caitlyn Jenner is running for governor of California, hoping to unseat Gavin Newsom, who is as unpopular as Gavin Newsom. Jenner, a Republican, has lived in California for over 50 years and considers herself fiscally conservative and socially liberal. Caitlyn said in a statement, for the past decade, we have seen the glimmer of the Golden State reduced by one-party rule that places politics over progress, damn straight, and special interests over people. I agree. Sacramento needs an honest leader with a clear vision. Hear, hear. The big question, will Jenner pull in the crucial ex-Olympian transgendered conservative reality show star voter demographic? One thing is for sure, Democrats will have to get very creative in trying to argue that voting for her is transphobic. Caitlyn's appeal could cross gender boundaries as easily as Caitlyn crossed gender boundaries.
100% there. I think that's going to be very interesting. And I hope she succeeds, because I think what's going on in California and certainly in New York is just crazy. Anyway, just my two cents.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. For the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it.
Well, new developments today in the so-called Climate Gate scandal. Penn State climate professor Michael Mann has come under fire from his critics, who accuse him of manipulating some of his data to present fake evidence of global warming. Now Mann is threatening to bring a lawsuit over this spoof, which has gone viral.
Had the decline.
Truth is an absolute defense to any defamation claim, so can he prove that what they claim about him is not true?
I don't think he can. I mean, this is just goes to show you how the mighty have fallen. Michael Mann was a top UN scientist who is now, in 2010, spending his time worrying about YouTube videos. This video is absolutely accurate. Michael Mann is the inventor of the temperature hockey stick, which even recently the Royal UK Statistical Society said was exaggerated. Other German scientists have called it statistical rubbish. He's been called a statistical charlatan. He has had report after report attacking the foundation. The idea that 20th century temperatures are unprecedented is what Michael Mann is peddling through the UN. He has been shown to be wrong repeatedly.
He faced investigations both by Penn State and in England, and both found his work to be acceptable. So does Mr. Mann have a case? I mean, but does he have a point?
No, this in the case of Penn State, it was actually just a local group of Penn State officials, and they actually referred it to further investigation. They cleared him on a few charges, but said he needed further investigation. In the case of the UK, it was run by someone named Lord Oxburgh, who actually has tied vested interests in the green climate industry. And people said it's like Dracula guarding the blood bank. That investigation has been trashed, even by UN sympathizers, as a whitewash. Michael Mann is facing serious, serious credibility problems.
Okay, so the next clip I'm going to show you goes into the actual math, what they did, how they did it, and it stinks to high heaven.
Paper appeared in the prestigious journal Nature that would go on to be one of the most contentious and influential climate science papers of all time. Its lead author was Michael E. Mann, at the time a young researcher just starting his career. From the initials of Mann and his co-authors, the paper came to be called MBH-98. But to many people, it's best known for introducing the famous hockey stick graph. Based on a statistical analysis of tree rings and other natural formations, it purported to show the average annual temperature of the Northern Hemisphere back to AD 1400 as basically flatlining the handle for hundreds of years until it suddenly shot upward, the blade, in the 20th century. A year later, the same authors published an extended version going back to AD 1000. Both versions presented the same stunning picture. The world's climate had apparently followed a steady, gentle cooling trend for 900 years. Then in the 20th century, a violent warming trend began, unlike anything in the past millennium. The authors fingered rising CO2 emissions as the culprit. Within 2 years, the hockey stick rocketed to international fame after becoming the centerpiece of the 2001 report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, where it appeared 6 times, always in full color, and was heavily promoted at an international press conference by IPCC Chairman Sir John Houghton. Governments around the world began using the hockey stick, with the full authority of the IPCC behind it, to promote the global warming alarm just 2 months after MBH-98 appeared. Nature published another climate reconstruction, this time by the late British scientist Keith Briffa and 4 co-authors. Like Mann's study, it used tree ring records from all over the Northern Hemisphere to estimate temperatures back to the year 1400. But unlike Mann's paper, the result looked nothing like a hockey stick. It showed a lot of variability over time and record warmth in the 1930s, but no special warming patterns since then. In fact, it showed cooling up to 1993, with temperatures ending below the average of the past 6 centuries. The study of ancient climate conditions is called paleoclimatology. In the first report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change back in 1990, they summarized the conventional view among paleoclimate experts that at the end of the last ice age, about 10,000 years ago, the climate warmed for about 4,000 years, reached a state much warmer than the present, and stayed there for several millennia, then began cycling between cooling and warming. The Roman era and the medieval era were both relatively warm compared to the present, and the Little Ice Age, which ended in the early 1800s, was relatively cold. And now we're in another warm phase of the cycle. Though according to the conventional view as of 1990, it's nothing special compared to previous eras. The 1990 IPCC diagram of the familiar cycle matches other records, such as this long-term temperature reconstruction from ice cores taken out of the Greenland ice cap. Similar evidence for past warming episodes comes from the Riviera Boniface region in the Ungava Peninsula of northern Quebec. In 1997, Scientists from Laval University in Quebec published evidence of the remains of a black spruce forest preserved in peat in the Arctic tundra. The trees grew over an interval spanning 1000 BC to almost 1600 AD.
How could there be a forest in the Arctic? Simple. It used to be warmer there than it is to this day. Periods of rapid forest growth there happened during the Roman and medieval warm periods. But a major fire in the late 1500s wiped out the trees, and it's been too cold for them to grow back ever since.
Later, a large library of emails among Jones, Briffa, Mann, and other climate scientists would be leaked onto the internet, which is how we came to possess the inside details of what happened next. On September 22, 1999, 3 weeks after the Arusha meeting, IPCC coordinating lead author Chris Folland sent around a note stating, "A proxy diagram of temperature change is a clear favorite for the policymaker's summary. But the current diagram, with the tree ring only data, BRIFA's, somewhat contradicts the MAN multi-proxy curve and dilutes the message rather significantly. So he asked that MAN's curve be given priority. The black line is MAN's curve, the pink one is Jones's, and the green one peeking from behind was BRIFA's modified data, attributed to a later paper published in 2000. The red line leading upwards at the end was from modern thermometer data. The diagram suggested, amazingly, that all the data were in perfect agreement. The green curve was supposedly the one BRIFA submitted to the IPCC. But it goes up to 1994 in the journal article, whereas the IPCC version stopped at 1960. McIntyre hunted through some online data archives and found the full BRIFA series, then drew what the IPCC diagram would have looked like if they had used all the data.
The reason why BRIFA's data was a problem for them was that his temperature reconstruction from tree rings went sharply down in the last half of the 20th century when temperatures were going up. So the question for any rational observer was, if tree ring data went down while temperature went up, what makes you think that these are a good measurement or a good proxy for temperatures?
I've just completed Mike's nature trick of adding in the real temps to each series for the last 20 years, that is from 1981 onwards, and from 1961 for Keith's, to hide the decline.
Jones was referring to this chart, which, like the IPCC diagram, made it look like all the data sets agreed and showed unprecedented recent warming. It achieved this effect by deleting the BRIFA data after 1960, splicing in thermometer data to each series up to the year 2000, then smoothing over the splice, as Jones said, to hide the decline. That's quite the trick.
The main investigative team was headed by Moore Russell, and it conceded that a minor wrist slap was in order for this incident. In relation to hide the decline, we find that, given its subsequent iconic significance, not least the use of a similar figure in the IPCC report, the figure supplied for the WMO report was misleading in not describing that one of the series was truncated post-1960 for the figure, and in not being clear on the fact that proxy and instrumental data were spliced together.
Wow. So, manipulation. Now, the problem is that every government department or government agency are developing policies based on this single source from the IPCC, done by man, with discounted, contradictory information, discounted everything else, manipulated data, and every environmental agency that is advising governments around the world are using the same falsified data.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. COVID debunked. Okay. Are we doing anything else? Yeah. New York Fine Frenzy. Will's gone mad. All right.
I'm a medical specialist in pathology and graduate of Cambridge University, UK. I've had many leadership roles in medicine, both provincially and nationally, including those as a university teacher, board examiner, and laboratory accreditation inspector. I was previously the president of the Alberta Society of Laboratory Physicians, otherwise known as pathologists, and have been an assistant professor in the Faculty of Medicine at the U of A. I have also been active in public health advocacy for many years as honorary chairman of ASH, Action on Smoking and Health. ASH is the leading nonprofit organization tackling the predatory marketing practices of big tobacco. I'm not an anti-vaxxer, conspiracy theorist, or great resetter. I've spent my entire career in evidence-based medicine. In essence, public health is the practice of medicine at a societal level, and it should follow standard medical ethics where every act is performed for good reason. That is no different from the obligation of an individual physician to his or her patient. Society is in fact the patient of the chief medical officer of health. And in medicine, the primary ethic is the Hippocratic Oath, first do no harm. But that concept appears to have been totally ignored, as the harmful consequences are by any measure grotesquely disproportional to any of the purported benefits. The cure is far worse than the disease. All the measures being currently undertaken, including masks, these things, I'm sure you're familiar with them, social distancing and closures of all kinds have no consensus for effectiveness in the medical literature. And in fact, the weight of evidence is against these measures. Let me state emphatically again, nothing works to control the spread of this virus. There should have been no change in public policy compared to previous pandemics. Life should not have changed one iota, except for enhanced protection of the vulnerable. Trying to protect the working well with very low risk of death by shutting down the economy is obviously ridiculously naive. Public hysteria, in turn, is being used by politicians to double down on mandates known to be ineffective. If one mask isn't working today, we recommend two or maybe 10 next week. Failure of due diligence from the very get-go on the absurd computer modeling by Dr. Neil Ferguson at Imperial College London. That was the most singular failure, as it became the predicate for similarly exaggerated responses. Failure to inform the public that there was no consensus in the medical literature for any of the draconian restrictions so arbitrarily introduced. Failure to report to the general public the cumulative adverse consequences of the interventions on general health care, dying relatives, funerals, weddings, church services, school closures, graduations, and thousands of small business bankruptcies. On the way here today, I drove past Grace Life Church. The double steel cordon is still around that church. Failure to halt the testing of asymptomatic people. It should stop immediately. It has no purpose. Failure to produce detailed statistical reporting to inform the working well in lay terms about the actual degree of risk from COVID and that variants, as Dr. Modri indicated, are nothing to fear. Failure to classify deaths appropriately. The vulnerable population with many comorbidities who happen to be COVID positive at the time of their death are being classified as deaths directly due to COVID. That is statistical sleight of hand. Dying with COVID is not the same as dying of COVID. Failure to promote the life-saving potential of vitamin D, which is totally safe, cheap, and has overwhelming evidence of protection from COVID-19. What used to be called the season of coughs and colds is now being recognized as the season of vitamin D deficiency. In a month or so, the sun will come up again, and we will all start making vitamin D in our skin. And guess what? The pandemic will disappear again. And they'll say, see, We wrestled it to the ground. To which I say, no such thing. It's the classic fallacy trap. Just because B follows A does not mean that A caused B. Wake up! Failure to communicate to the general public the inadequacies of PCR testing. There are no published statistics in Alberta regarding the percentage of false positive results by PCR-based methods. Failure to inform the public that the vaccines are all strictly experimental, lacking the customary 2 to 4 years adverse event trials, and therefore, in my view, by any definition, unsafe. That is a failure, a spectacular failure, of the second important medical ethic, that of informed consent. There was no need for a rushed vaccine given the scale of risk. And in my opinion, its use is profoundly reckless. Indeed, there are concerns about its safety now for women under 50 and pregnant women already surfacing, which proves the point in spades. The vaccine situation has the potential, of course, of getting infinitely worse if so-called vaccine passports come to play. Yes, they'll say, you can refuse the vaccine if you want, if you think it's unsafe. But you know what? You won't be allowed to travel. How outrageous! The profound loss of personal freedom resulting from the various mandates are an unforgivable assault on the very essence of our humanity and totally unwarranted given the scale of threat. This is not Ebola. This is not SARS. In fact, Sweden and Florida clearly demonstrate that draconian actions have little impact on the final toll from COVID. However, even to debate these questions is now stigmatized by government, the media, and professional colleges as irresponsible and to be resolutely suppressed. The entire population has been intimidated into compliance with the threat of outrageous fines and actual jail for disobedience. The government's encouragement of citizens to snitch on each other is utterly reprehensible. So in summary, these numerous failures of the government of Alberta in the COVID pandemic have directly caused the most monstrous loss of freedoms, unwarranted fear, and horrendous personal consequences ever recorded in our province, and all without any justifiable cause. The general public must never again have their rights so trampled on, while we are perfectly capable of managing this type of problem ourselves, independent of any government intervention, as we have done so effectively in years gone by. Nothing works to stop the spread of this virus through society. Nothing could work, nothing did work, and nothing will work. This virus must just be allowed to run its course. Government must simply accommodate to medicine's impotence and allow the public to use its abundant common sense.
Statistically, if 75% of all COVID cases are people from 60 or 65 and over, wouldn't you think we could just quarantine those people, the most vulnerable, quarantine them? So if you want to go and see grandpa or grandma or see your mum and dad, there's a quarantine period, you can visit themselves under certain controls and let everyone else get on with their lives. So we in Australia, we have the same thing. The Prime Minister here has done quote-unquote as good a job, if you can detect my sarcasm, as good a job as any. Right, just slowly, slowly eroding our freedoms annoys me no end. And we have a Prime Minister here that says, oh, we're all in this together, yet as we're going bankrupt, and losing our jobs, losing our wages, losing our savings, he still earned $9,000 a week plus his tax-free expense accounts or per diems. And in the middle of the lockdown last year, in 2020, they all gave themselves another $1,000 a week pay rise. That's $10,000 a week. Class. So, Mr. Morrison, you and your guys, you're not in part of the we, okay? So when you say we're all in this together, you're not part of the we, because you got every week you got paid.
Are you the Judean People's Front?
Fuck off.
What?
Judean People's Front. Well, the People's Front of Judea.
Ta-da! I've got to think of some sort of theme music to put on here. But welcome, everybody. This is episode 2. Episode 1, obviously, was last week. We're going to bring these out every Monday and hope you can join us. We're going to talk about lots of things today, so let's jump right into it. Just for a change of pace. Amazing story. So the backstory is this guy buys a painting for about $2,000 in a Louisiana garage sale, and then it follows from there. So enjoy this. This is going to be a lot of fun.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, we move to the Leonardo da Vinci, the Salvator Mundi, the masterpiece by Leonardo of Christ the Saviour, previously in the collections of three kings of England.
That 110 million will give me 120, give me 140, 130 million, 140 million is bid at 140 million.
I always thought it would be the most expensive work of art ever sold. It's incredible and unbelievably rare. Nothing conjures with the name of Leonardo. We had tens of thousands of people on three continents line up for hours in some cases, and people were tremendously excited to see it.
I've known Robert Simon for a very long time, and Robert had purchased the painting sometime, I think it was in April of 2005, he called and asked if he could bring a picture over that he had just purchased. And I asked Bob if he wanted me to go ahead and clean it. It had very recent kind of sticky varnish on it and some sloppy retouching that also looked quite recent.
It was heavily overpainted and it was thought to be a copy, and it was sold for a couple thousand dollars at an estate sale in Louisiana. It was found by a man named Alex Parrish, who then sold a share of it to Robert Simon, who is a very distinguished authority on Italian Renaissance paintings. Thought he must be crazy when he said he thought he might have found Leonardo da Vinci. And they started having it cleaned, and at that point, the quality of it really began to come through, and they got quite excited, and they brought in Diane Modestini, who's a very distinguished restorer in New York. By the time he paints at around 1500, Leonardo is almost 50. He's the most famous artist in the world. There is an assumption that it must have been for a very important patron. He used very, very precious materials, and he finishes it, which he doesn't do that often. He starts a lot and abandons it along the way, but he finishes this. Contents of it are sold off at an auction in 1763. And at that point, it just completely disappears. We have no idea what happened. Until the end of the 19th century, when it reappears and it's sold to a very eminent British collector, Francis Cook. But it's sold as a copy or a follower of Leonardo. And you can see it's heavily overpainted. It was sort of just made to look more masculine. I think it was probably seen as more fitting by the 19th century. And it remains in the Cook collection, where nobody pays much attention to it until 1958. When it's sold at Sotheby's in London for £45. It's bought by an American, we think, and it ends up in collections in America until 2005, when it's sold for, again, a very, very small amount of money as a copy in Louisiana.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, we move to the Leonardo da Vinci, the Salvator Mundi, the masterpiece by Leonardo of Christ the Saviour, previously in the collections of three kings of England. At 90 million. 95, and I go 110 over here. 110. I have it at 110 million. Who will give me 120? Give me 140, 130 million. 140 million is bid. At 140 million, with Alex at 140 million, 150 might take it. At 140 million holding at the moment. Where is that? 150, welcome. At 150 million on the left, 160 might take it. At 150 million, many places still. 160 is bid back to Alex at 160 million. At 190 million, give me 200. 190 is bid. 200 million is bid. At 200 million. At 200 million. 200 million, please. 200 million is bid. Give me 10. At 200 million is bid. 200 million is here. Currently hanging with Alex on my right. At 200 million for the Leonardo. At 200 million looking for 210. Sir, are you coming back in? At 240 million. Currently. 245 million is bid. At 245 million. 250 million is bid. It's back to François de Porter at $266 million. $268 million, you heard it, ladies and gentlemen. Back to Alex at $268. Are we all out here? It's at $270 million, the hand goes up. $270 against you. Alex, would you like 275? Might do the trick. 270 million, back to François de Porter. Loic, are you out? You all done? Want to pop back in with a five? 280. 280 million, the increment of 10 million, ladies and gentlemen, at 280 million. With Alex, at $280 million. Are we all done? Maybe not. Don't take the photograph quite yet. 286 million. 286 million. Will you give me 290, Alex?
300.
I thought so. 300 million. Let's see if that's done it. 300 million. At 300 million is still with Alex. At $300 million for Salvatore Mundi by Leonardo da Vinci. At $315 million, not yours at the moment. Give me a bid. 318 is bid. The hand went up at 318 million now. At $318 million, with Francois, 320 million, we're still not done. At 320 million, at 320 million now. Give me five, Francois, 320 I have. 320 million, I'll have to hurry you. At 320, 328 million. 328 million. Back to François de Porter. 330 million. At 330 million now. Would you like five? 330 million is bid, ladies and gentlemen, and selling at 330 million with Alex's clients ahead of you here at 132 million, back to Francois, at 332 million. 332 is the number. 335? For those of you following online, you may not have heard it. The bid was 350 was called on the telephone. At 350 million for Leonardo Salvador Mundi. At 350 million. Here at Christie's, at 350 million and looking for another bid, please, Francois. At 350. The conversation continues. So we will pause at 350 million. $352 million. $352 million is bid at $352 million. $355 million is bid. Would you like 340? 360, I beg your pardon. 355 is bid. 355 is bid. 360 will be next. 370 is bid. 370 million. 370 million. Back to Francois's client at $370 million, ladies and gentlemen. 400 million. $400 million is the bid. Here in the sale room at $400 million with Alex Rotter, the bid is here at $400 million. For the Salvatore Mundi at $400 million. Francois is out. Are you sure, Francois? At $400 million then. Thank you all for your bidding here and on the telephone to my left. And of course here, Loic and Francois. It is with Alex Rotter at $400 million. Leonardo Salvatore Mundi selling here at Christie's. $400 million is the bid, and the piece is sold.
Just what I love about these auctions, and if this goes to real estate or art or anything, is that, you know, there's lots of clapping and everyone's happy. And even the buyer who has just lost, or his bank account is now being decreased by 400 million US, is probably celebrating. I think it's hilarious. Usually, you know, the person that's paying is the one that's usually grimacing because their bank account has gone down. But auctions, it always... The people who, obviously the guy who sold it and the people around it are celebrating, but the person who's actually, his bank account has dropped, is celebrating. I think that's always quite funny to think. That's what I think about anyway. Nice work. So I think it ended up being bought by a Saudi prince. So it's just petrol money anyway. And I think it's at the Louvre Museum at the Abu Dhabi. I think it's Abu Dhabi. Anyway, it's at the Abu Dhabi Museum. So the Louvre has Mona Lisa, and now they have the Salvatore Mundi. Okay. Well, I hope you enjoyed the session, and next Monday, please tune in, like, subscribe, do all the things that you need to do. And I look forward to seeing you guys next week. Until then, stay awesome. See ya.